Lieber Ralf Füchs, vielen herzlichen Dank für die freundliche Einführung. Ich denke, ich kann auch im Namen von Josef Janning, dem Co-Leiter der ICFA in Berlin, kennt auch das Modell der Doppelspitze, sagen, dass wir uns sehr freuen, auch die diesjährige außenpolitische Jahrestagung der Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung erneut mit unterstützen zu dürfen. Vielen herzlichen Dank dafür. Es ist für uns eine spannende Gelegenheit. Der ICFA versucht ja, Themen qua Aufstellung der eigenen Institutionen europäisch zu denken. Wir arbeiten miteinander an 7 Standorten in der Europäischen Union und versuchen, Expertise zusammenzubringen, die die Perspektiven aus unterschiedlichen EU-Mitgliedstaaten immer mit einbezieht. Ich freue mich, dass auch Kolleginnen und Kollegen da sind, das heute mit uns zu tun und auch morgen im Rahmen der Fachkonferenz. Ich möchte Sie begrüßen. Guten Abend, das ist eine Freude und eine Ehre, dass ich hier heute Abend mit durch den Abend führen darf. Ich möchte Ihnen ganz kurz vorstellen, wie wir den heutigen Abend miteinander verbringen werden, denn wir haben uns eine ganze Menge vorgenommen. Ralf Füchs hat das Menü angerichtet. Die Themen liegen auf dem Tisch. Es sind schwierige Themen, es sind Themen mit unendlich vielen Facetten. Und wir werden versuchen, mit Ihnen hier heute Abend und mit sehr interessanten Gästen, die das Menü noch anreichern werden, mit Ihnen ins Gespräch zu kommen über die Lage der internationalen Politik, über die Lage der Welt und zu hören, wie man darüber nachdenkt an verschiedenen Orten dieser Welt. Wir werden das zunächst folgendermaßen tun. Ich stelle gleich unsere Auftaktrednerin Angela Stent vor, die uns einführen wird in den Abend. Anschließend haben wir Gelegenheit mit Wolfgang Ischinger und Raja Mohan, auch beide werde ich anschließend noch ausführlicher vorstellen, hier auf dem Podium miteinander über diesen inhaltlichen Aufschlag von Professor Stent zu diskutieren. Dann haben Sie sicherlich schon eine ganze Menge Dinge, die Ihnen durch den Kopf gehen. Sie haben die Gelegenheit, die auch noch ein bisschen zu sortieren und miteinander auszutauschen, denn wir machen eine kurze Kaffeepause, wo man miteinander ins Gespräch kommen kann, vielleicht schon mal das eine oder andere zuspitzen kann, denn dann wollen wir hier ja in eine größere Podiumsrunde gehen mit Ralf Füchs, mit Tom Königs, dem Bundestagsabgeordneten, und mit Ihnen. Und wir wollen Ihre Perspektiven hören, wir wollen gerne Ihre Fragen hören, Ihre Einschätzungen hören, freuen uns darauf. Ich weise schon jetzt darauf hin oder bitte darum, dass wir das, weil wir sehr viele sind, was fantastisch ist, so tun, dass möglichst viele Stimmen auch zu Wort kommen können. Aber ich bin mir ganz sicher, dass wir das schaffen werden. Denn der Abend, das glaube ich, wissen zumindest diejenigen, die sich noch für andere Dinge als für internationale Beziehungen interessieren, hat ja, sagen wir mal, auch ein natürliches Ende möglicherweise. Insofern keine Sorge, diejenigen, die sich auch für den runden Ball interessieren, werden zu ihrem Recht kommen. Aber vielleicht wollen andere noch länger bleiben, mal gucken. Insofern, das wäre die Art und Weise, wie wir den Abend mit Ihnen heute gestalten wollen. Europa in einer friedlosen Welt. Ich freue mich sehr, dass wir begrüßen dürfen für den einführenden Vortrag Frau Professor Dr. Angela Stent. Frau Professor Stent ist Direktorin des Zentrums für Eurasische, Russische und Osteuropäische Studien und Professor of Government and Foreign Service an der Georgetown University. Eine ausgewiesene Expertin, eine der führenden Expertinnen in, ja, sagen wir, dem Dreieck der Beziehungen zwischen Russland, den Vereinigten Staaten und Europa mit einer großen Schaffenskraft, mit scharfer Analyse für verschiedene akademische Institutionen, für Thinktanks, aber auch für die Regierung in verschiedenen Funktionen gearbeitet, für den National Intelligence Council, für das Office of Policy Planning des amerikanischen Außenministeriums. Derzeit ist sie Fellow an der Transatlantic Academy des German Marshall Fund und sie hat im Jahr 2014 ihr jüngstes Buch mit besonderem Erfolg noch einmal veröffentlicht, The Limits of Partnership, US-Russian Relations in the 21st Century, erschienen bei Princeton University Press. Dieses Buch wurde als bestes Buch zur Praxis der amerikanischen Diplomatie mit dem Douglas Dillon Prize der American Academy of Diplomacy ausgezeichnet. Das heißt, wir freuen uns natürlich besonders, mit ihm jemanden zu haben, der nicht nur die akademische Perspektive auf diese wirklich komplexen Themen abdecken kann, sondern sehr vertraut ist mit der Praxis von Politik, mit den Zwängen, mit dem Umfeld von Politik, eben nicht nur im Kontext ihres eigenen Landes, sondern darüber hinaus Europa und der Russischen Föderation. Frau Professor Stent, wir freuen uns sehr, dass Sie da sind. Der Angela, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Good afternoon, I guess it still is, ladies and gentlemen. Some colleagues and friends, some of whom I haven't seen for a long time. I would like to thank the Böll Stiftung very much for giving me the opportunity to give this keynote today. I have great respect for the work that the foundation does and is doing in Russia and in Ukraine, and for the Green Party's principled positions on Russia and Ukraine and other of Russia's neighbors. I admire the analysis of Jens Siegert in Moscow, the work of Marie-Louise Beck, and her support for civil society in the post-Soviet space. So it's a great pleasure to speak to you today. So I was asked the question, are Europe and the United States still in the same world, particularly when they deal with Russia? And I'm going to rephrase it slightly. Are America, Europe, and Russia in the same world? To which I am going to answer that despite all of our differences, Europe and the United States are in the same world, but Russia is indeed in another world. As Chancellor Merkel said very perceptively to President Obama after the onset of the Ukraine crisis. And herein lies our main challenge. How do we deal with a Russia that increasingly views the world through a different lens than does the West? So you might ask, and I think particularly an audience at the Böll Stiftung, how can I say that the United States and Europe are in the same world? Of course we have our differences, and I'm sure many of them will come out, but I believe that we still remain part of the same community of values, a Wertegemeinschaft. We remain committed to the basic values of democracy, of rule of law, freedom of expression, freedom of assembly, due process, and respect for human rights, for minority rights, for non-discrimination against ethnic or religious minorities, and the protection of the rights of the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgendered communities. So these are values that at least our governments and our political systems enshrine. But of course, we have differences over other values. We disagree over important issues such as the death penalty, gun rights, privacy, especially obviously connected to the Edward Snowden revelations, and the legitimacy of the use of hard power internationally. But these disagreements between governments and maybe what our legal systems have do not necessarily reflect the views of civil society. And so there are many people in America who share European criticisms of the death penalty, of gun rights, and of the activities of the National Security Agency. And of course, not all Europeans agree on these issues either, particularly in the expanded EU. So we also, Europe and the United States, face many of the same international challenges which we've just heard about. Terrorism, unprecedented migration flows, and those affect Europe much more than the United States, obviously. And of course, the impact of climate change. And add to this an increasingly assertive Russia that has abandoned the Helsinki principles of the inviolability of borders and respect for national sovereignty, a Russia that supports populist, intolerant movements in Europe and to a lesser extent in the United States. And another challenge, of course, is a rising China, whose longer-term international intentions are unclear, but who, with Russia, promotes a model of authoritarian, state-directed capitalism and represses freedom of expression and assembly. And both China and Russia agree that Western values of democracy, they regard the attempt to promote those with great suspicion. So my remarks today will focus on Russia and the challenge it presents, and how Europe and the United States have responded to it. Of course, I will towards the end say something about our own election campaign, since the United States is increasingly becoming a factor of instability internationally. So, at its most basic, if we look at Europe, the United States, and Russia, it's an issue of Yalta versus Helsinki, of the Russians' 20th century vision of the great powers dividing Europe again versus the transatlantic belief that we share of the importance of respecting the sovereignty and independence of the states in Europe and of the states in the difficult neighborhood that lie between Russia and Europe. So far, the transatlantic community has responded to Russian actions with great unity. The question is, how long will this last? Because we have an unexpected transatlantic consensus since the annexation of Crimea. So for a moment, I think we do need to put ourselves in Russia's shoes, or let me say the Kremlin's shoes, and try and understand how the Kremlin views the world and whether it is indeed living in our world. And I would say the current worldview in the Kremlin harkens back both to an imperial Russian and certainly a Soviet dialectical view of the world, that it is the West against Russia, and that the West is out to weaken, destroy Russia. You hear this all the time from the president of Russia, but also from other officials. And from this essentially dialectical view, the view of the West as the enemy, flow several maxims. So Russia believes that it does have the right to a seat at the table on all important international decisions, and that the United States and its allies have been denying Russia this right since the Soviet collapse. And we saw an example of that in last September when President Putin made sure that Russia would be the power that everyone had to talk to about what was happening in Syria, when Russia began a bombing campaign in Syria and it gave the United States 1 hour's notice to get out of the skies. Secondly, Russia insists that it has a right to a sphere of influence in the post-Soviet space. It sometimes calls this the Russian Monroe Doctrine, without understanding that the Monroe Doctrine, the US relationship with Latin America, was operative during the Cold War era. It's not operative anymore. Those days have certainly gone. Russia believes that it has the right to make sure that no Euro-Atlantic structures, either the European Union or NATO, move any closer to Russia's borders. And I think we have to understand that Russia's, or the Kremlin's, let's say, definition of space and borders differs from a European definition or even from an American definition. It's a very expansive definition. And I think the men in the Kremlin believe that the borders of the former Soviet Union, this is really part of Russia's essential defense perimeter. It's not the border of the Russian Federation, it's the broader border of the former Soviet Union. And this also leads to a different concept of sovereignty. So President Putin has said on several occasions that there are only three or four truly sovereign countries in the world: Russia, China, and India. Why? Because they are not entangled by alliances. In this view, even the United States is not a truly sovereign country because we have allies, and that limits our freedom of maneuver. So it's absolute sovereignty for a few large countries. But the other side of this is the Kremlin's belief that the smaller countries, particularly those in Russia's neighborhood, have limited sovereignty and that they do not have the right to choose what their foreign policy orientation should be. And then we have the ideological dimension of the worldview from the Kremlin, and again, we heard about this a little bit in the introduction. Russia presents itself as an alternative, superior, civilizational model to what it says is the decadent West, Russia as the true harbinger of Christianity, again, against the satanic practices of the West, and that is the new conservative international that we heard about. And part of this is Russia presenting itself as a status quo power, as opposed to the revisionist United States, which goes around the world trying to implement regime change. So Russia is the country to go to if you oppose revolution, chaos, and liberal ideas. And hence, again, the Russian support, financial, moral, whatever, for right-wing and left-wing, actually, Eurosceptical parties in Europe. So The world that the Russia would strive, or the men in the Kremlin strive to create, is the Russian world, the Ruski Mir, embodying a civilization that caters really to the needs of the millions of Russians who found themselves outside of Russia's borders when the Soviet Union collapsed. So President Putin presents himself as the defender of all these Russians and Russian speakers in Ukraine and other countries. But this Russia is also presented as the defender of Russians who live in the West. And we already heard mention of our Lisa, unser Lisa case, anyway, as you've seen in Germany yourself. And this, I would say, this commitment to this broader Russian world in the former Soviet space, but also in Europe, in the United States too, by the way, is an ideological and a practical challenge to the transatlantic community. So the world that Europe and the United States hoped would emerge from the Cold War was one in which a newly liberated Russia would end 75 years of isolation from the international system and would seek to integrate with the Euro-Atlantic world. And it appeared in the early 1990s that this might be possible. Unfortunately, these Western expectations proved mistaken. I don't have time to go into the reasons for that, but we are now in a very different situation, and we are now living in a world in which Russia believes that its interests and its ideas have been neglected, and Russia explicitly seeks to create a new world order, ideally with China, in which it will have a much bigger say in defining the agenda. So, how have Europe and the United States responded to these challenges? And I will say a few words about Ukraine and even fewer words about Syria, because I know we're going to be talking about Syria tomorrow. We need to remember that the Ukraine crisis began because President Putin was determined to create a Eurasian Economic Union in his third term in office, and the EU's negotiations with Kyiv on an association agreement threatened that project. Since the annexation of Crimea and the launch of a war in the Donbas region, more than 10,000 people have died, and there are up to 2 million refugees and displaced people as a result of that conflict. So this is a humanitarian tragedy on Europe's doorstep. The US and Europe have been on the same world when it comes to responding to these actions. To Moscow's surprise, we have cooperated very well, and we have agreed on a sanctions regime as a way of trying to induce some change in Russian actions in Ukraine. We have a division of labor between the United States and Germany as the leader of the European sanctions effort. Germany leads the sanctions effort. The United States has done something to contribute to the military reassurance of its allies, those that are near Russia. We have a European reassurance initiative, which currently has about $3 billion committed for the next fiscal year to this effort. Now, Europe has borne the brunt of the sanctions against Russia, no doubt, and we see just this week, today, Jean-Claude Juncker and Nicolas Sarkozy and lots of European business people in St. Petersburg all saying that we should now be beginning to lift the sanctions. So far, it seems that maybe they will last for another 6 months. I would also say the other part of this division of labor is that the White House, again, in response to requests from Germany, has vetoed, so far, Congress's attempts to send lethal defensive weapons to the Ukrainians fighting in the Donbas region. So there's a lively debate about the impact of sanctions. Russia's economy is in decline. That's largely because of its own structural inability or unwillingness to reform, to introduce modernizing reforms. It's the result, obviously, of falling oil prices. But the sanctions have affected Russia adversely in terms of its ability to borrow money on capital markets. So they have had an impact, even though we haven't seen that impact politically yet in Ukraine. And therefore, in my opinion, it would be a mistake to begin to lift sanctions if there's no progress on the Minsk agreements. The problem is that these Minsk agreements appear to be frozen. They're very problematic because Russia interprets them differently than do Ukraine, Germany, and France, particularly the sequencing of what is supposed to happen. And there's some people both in Europe and in the United States arguing that maybe they need to be replaced. But so far, no one, I think, has come up with any good ideas about what you can replace them with. And I've heard diplomats argue that the process itself is important, even if the results are quite meager. Ukraine could become a more divisive issue between the United States and Europe if the situation remains static. And some countries decide, and some already have, or they question whether Ukraine itself is serious, the Ukrainian government, not the people, are seriously interested in putting its own house in order. Now, we have seen some signs of this emerging, and I will just refer you to a series of interviews that President Obama gave to the Atlantic Monthly, and what he said about Ukraine. He said that Ukraine is a core Russian interest and is not a core American interest, and that the U.S. was reluctant to intervene there because Russia would always be able to maintain escalatory dominance in Ukraine. And one quote from the interview, "The fact is Ukraine, which is a non-NATO country, is going to be vulnerable to military domination by Russia no matter what we do. We have to be very clear about what our core interests are and what we are really willing to go to war for." So that's, I think, a sober assessment of the situation, but it's also, I think, a signal that, of course, Europe and particularly Germany have taken the lead in trying to resolve the Ukrainian issue, but the United States is certainly taking more of a back seat there. So that's one issue. And I think the other issue is what's happening within the European Union and people's attitudes towards Russia. So I'm not going to talk about the so-called Putin-Versteher in Germany, but I am going to spend a minute on the countries that our former Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld famously named New Europe in 2003 at the time of the US invasion of Iraq, when he claimed that they were much more pro-American and anti-Russian. Well, it turns out that today Hungary, Slovakia, and to some extent the Czech Republic have become much more favorably inclined towards Russia than some of the old European countries, such as Germany or the UK. So if the current stalemate continues in Ukraine, I think you will certainly see the Kremlin very actively trying to make the best of relations with these other, you know, quote-unquote, new European countries, Central European countries, who are less now committed to Western solidarity on Russia. And of course, the same is true of the migrant crisis. And let me say one word about Syria. And again, we heard a little bit about that and the ambivalence there. This is a prime example, from the US point of view, of a compartmented relationship with Russia, an issue where we disagree with them on many issues, but we have to cooperate them with them because we would like to end the civil war and all the bloodshed there. So ever since Russia began its bombing campaign, we have daily contacts, US-Russian contacts, so that our air operations don't conflict with each other, that we don't have some terrible incident where a plane is shot down. Secretary Kerry, Foreign Minister Lavrov, also are in constant contact about trying to form some transition government away from the current government in Syria. But our interests, and that is to say the US, Europe, and our Arab allies in the coalition, our interests are fundamentally different from those of Russia. The Kremlin says that all opponents of President Assad, including ones that this coalition supports. They're all terrorists. It doesn't differentiate between any of them. And Russian actions and support of the Assad government have, of course, increased the migrant flows to Europe and placed extra burdens, particularly on Germany, but other countries that are taking migrants. So when we hear the Russian leadership say we should join forces in an anti-terrorist coalition, it's a perfect example of how we do live in different worlds, because we cannot agree with Russia on who a terrorist is. So let me say a word now about the US-German relationship. I was asked to address this because we are the two key players in responding to Russia. I would argue that our bilateral relations have improved significantly from the low point in 2003 when the US invaded Iraq. I'm going to be very interested to hear what Ambassador Ischinger has to say. He was the German ambassador, of course, in Washington, and he valiantly defended Germany's interests there, I think, very well. Of course, the relationship has been also burdened by and has suffered a blow, really, since the Snowden revelations. I'm quite aware of that, and those reverberations continue today. But still, I would say that from President Obama's point of view, Germany really is the key country. Somebody asked President Obama recently, who is your favorite world leader? And he said, Angela Merkel. And then they said, and who is your second favorite world leader? And he paused and said, Angela Merkel. So I think that these two leaders in many ways diagnose many of the international problems through a similar framework, and they certainly do live in the same world. Now, although the US is normally identified as a prime source of hard power, in this world, and that Germany is the exemplary example of soft power, the US and Germany have agreed that Russia's annexation of Crimea, its activities in Donbass, and of course what it's doing in the Baltic and Black Sea regions necessitate a more robust military response. The Ukraine crisis has given NATO a new lease of life, and it's also, I understand, even in Germany, caused a rethinking of some of the military priorities. So we have an upcoming Warsaw summit in which most member states will pledge to increase the amount of their GDP that they spend on defense. And we will have these four new combat battalions under the leadership of the US, the UK, Canada and Germany, and Germany is going to be a player here too, deploying these battalions to the Baltic Sea and Poland, again, to reassure allies and to send a signal. Yesterday, NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg talked about his concern about the continuing Russian military buildup, particularly on its Western Front. And he described this Warsaw summit as one of the most important in NATO's history, because of the changed international environment and the fact that the mission that NATO thought it would have after 1992, which was not one of opposing Russia or seeing Russia as an adversary, that mission has now begun to be rethunk, obviously, rethought in view of what's happened in the last few years. So I've talked about Russia as a factor of instability. I promised you I would also talk about the US as a factor of instability in this world. We have an extremely unpredictable and unprecedented electoral campaign going on, and at the moment the outcome is really not possible to predict. At the core of this unpredictability, of course, is the rise of Donald Trump. And when you look at the people who support him, it bears some similarity with some of the disaffected groups in Europe that support populist, anti-immigrant, right-wing groups. We have a shrinking middle class in the United States. We have more people that are becoming poorer. And of course, we have 1% of people who are very wealthy, and that is slightly increasing, but mainly the shrinking middle class is going downwards. These people feel that they are the losers from globalization. Many of them, their wages haven't risen in 10 years. They believe their children will be worse off than they were. And they blame, rightly or wrongly, globalization for this, mainly wrongly. And these people, and don't forget the core of Trump's supporters are white, male, less educated people. They also believe that the Obama administration in 8 years has neglected their interests and has focused on the interests of other groups in the United States. And therefore, this is the familiar refrain, he says what we do not dare to say. So this is the Trump phenomenon. Now, in terms of foreign policy, both Trump and, of course, Bernie Sanders from the left have attracted voters by questioning some of the basic traditional international policies of the United States, for instance, such as promoting free trade. Even Hillary Clinton, who of course, when she was Secretary of State, was a very traditional internationalist, even she has now gone back on her support, for instance, for the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and has said that she wouldn't ratify it. And this isn't even talking about TTIP, which may or may not come up in our discussion period. But of course, Donald Trump has gone much further than that. He's questioned the viability and value of NATO. He said he doesn't really see why we need it anymore. He says Japan and South Korea should get nuclear weapons, something that we've been trying to prevent for a very long time. And he has criticized China very, very sharply. And of course, he's criticized or he's questioned the basic American tradition of opening its arms to immigrants, people who want to come and live in the United States. And I gather yesterday he specifically criticized Chancellor Merkel for her refugee policy. So there's one leader internationally that Mr. Trump has praised, and that is Vladimir Putin. He has said that if he's elected president, he would go to Russia, Moscow, and he would make a deal. I have asked one of his foreign policy advisors, and there are not too many people who admit to being that, but I asked one of them, what's the nature of the deal? I don't think anybody knows. But certainly the Kremlin is very interested in Donald Trump, apparently even going so far as to have hackers hack into the site of the Democratic Party and to get its files on Donald Trump. That's interesting, isn't it? Now, I cannot predict the outcome of the election. If Hillary Clinton wins, then I think you'll see continuity, roughly, in US policy. I don't see any major discontinuities. And we will still live in the same world. If Donald Trump wins, then we will be in a new reality. Finally, let me, I don't want to go on too long, say something about the West dealing with Russia going forward. We already heard the question, are we in a new Cold War? We're not in the classic Cold War where you had US-Soviet military ideological rivalry. I would say we're maybe in a Cold War 2.0, certainly if you listen to some of the rhetoric from both sides. Vladimir Putin will no doubt win re-election in 2018. And then the question will be, what is his agenda? Will we see the side of Putin that's more pragmatic and transactional? Is he going to be willing to sit down again with the West or not? And we don't know that. The Russians seek, of course, a new Euro-Atlantic security order, again, one based on Yalta principles. And so the question we in Europe and the US have to ask is, how would we envisage that? Would we be prepared to say formally what is informally true, of course, that neither the European Union nor NATO is likely to offer Ukraine or any other post-Soviet country membership for the foreseeable future? If we were to say that formally, we would really be reneging on all the principles of the post-Cold War European peace order, but there are some pressures to do that. So in the absence of that, we will continue to have limited engagement with Russia on issues such as Ukraine and Syria, the Arctic, Iran, North Korea. I don't believe we should pursue dialogue for its own sake, but obviously targeted engagement has to happen and should happen. But I think we have to understand that Russia could challenge us somewhere else, either in its neighborhood or beyond the neighborhood in the near future. And that it's important for us, US and Europe, to continue to live in the same world and hope that one day Russia will want to rejoin that world. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you very much, Angela Stand. That was a very deep analysis and rich analysis. We're very grateful for that. Ich würde gerne sozusagen dieses Gespräch ein wenig weiterführen auf dem Podium mit weiteren Gästen und würde die einfach bitten, mit mir nach vorne zu kommen. Frau Professor Sand, Botschafter Ischinger Ratchamohan, wir kommen hier vielleicht einfach von rechts oben auf die Bühne. Ja, nochmal ganz herzlichen Dank für Ihre Ausführungen. Ich freue mich, wir haben jetzt den Punkt erreicht, ich hatte das eingangs gesagt, wo wir nochmal ein wenig hier zwischen Experten, Expertinnen auf dem Podium miteinander uns verständigen möchten, auf die Ausführungen von Frau Stand antworten wollen und haben dazu zwei besonders geeignete Gäste hier auf diesem Podium. Ich freue mich sehr, Herr Botschafter Ischinger, dass Sie da sind, Vorsitzender der Münchner Sicherheitskonferenz, auch Senior Professor for Security Policy and Diplomatic Practice an der Hertie School of Governance. Sie haben seit vielen Jahren, seit 2008 inzwischen, den Vorsitz der Münchner Sicherheitskonferenz inne. Sie waren Botschafter, das ist erwähnt worden von Angela Stand in Washington, unter anderem in Großbritannien, ein weiteres Land, was in diesen Fragen sicherlich auch etwas beizutragen hätte. Wir warten, was passiert in der nächsten Woche. Sie sind, und auch das hat Frau Stand angesprochen, derzeit Vorsitzender des OSZE Panel of Eminent Persons on European Security. Insofern sind wir gespannt, was Sie berichten können über das, was Angela Stand in den Raum gestellt hat. Also wie steht es um die Rolle der OSZE? Vielen herzlichen Dank, dass Sie heute da sind. Sie werden den Erstkommentar machen. Und ich begrüße sehr, sehr herzlich auch in dieser Runde Herrn Dr. Ratchamohan, den Direktor von Carnegie India in Neu-Delhi. Es ist wunderbar, Sie sind sozusagen als Außenansicht angekündigt. Das klingt fast ein bisschen unfreundlich, deswegen will ich unterstreichen, dass das überhaupt das Gegenteil ist. Denn es geht uns natürlich hier darum, verschiedene Perspektiven auf diese komplexen Themen zu gewinnen. Und das ist sehr gut, dass Sie da sind als einer der führenden Experten zur indischen Außenpolitik, zu Fragen der Sicherheit in Südasien, zur Großmachtbeziehung im asiatischen Raum und zur Rüstungskontrolle. Sie sind außerdem jemand, der in Interaktion tritt mit der Öffentlichkeit über Ihre Tätigkeit als außenpolitischer Kolumnist des Indian Express und außerdem Gastforscher im Institute of South Asian Studies der Nationaluniversität Singapur. Vorher Mitglied des Indian National Security Advisory Board und in anderer Rolle zuvor auch in der akademischen Lehre tätig. Sehr schön, dass Sie da sind, Herr Mohan, die weite Reise gemacht haben. Herzlich willkommen. Ja, und without further ado, Herr Botschafter Ischinger, Ihre Einschätzungen zu Angela Stand, Ihre Reaktionen, Ihre Disagreements, Ihre Bereiche, in denen Sie sagen, stimme ich zu, fehlt mir was, sehe ich anders, was ist Ihre Perspektive?
Zunächst einmal vielen Dank für die Einladung. Ich finde es großartig, hier mit Angela und mit Raja und natürlich mit Ihnen, Frau Müller, diskutieren zu können. Lassen Sie mich mal so anfangen. Wir haben ja beschlossen, Angela spricht Englisch, wir sprechen Deutsch und Ratchamohan wird auch versuchen, Deutsch zu sprechen, habe ich verstanden. Not really. Also, ich muss mich mit den Ausführungen von Angela Stand überhaupt nicht kritisch auseinandersetzen, weil ich mit den Grundthesen kein Problem habe. Ich würde gerne zwei, drei Anmerkungen machen. Erste Anmerkung zu dem Thema Trump, zu dem Thema Election. Es ist ja schlimm genug gewesen, dass wir in Europa Führungspersönlichkeiten von ähnlichem Erscheinungsbild hatten. Ich denke beispielsweise an den Kameraden Berlusconi zum Beispiel, nicht der Einzige. Der Unterschied ist, und da spricht in mir eben wirklich der Transatlantiker, der Unterschied ist, den Berlusconi, den haben wir zwar unter Schmerzen ausgehalten. Die Führung der Weltmacht USA ist aber eine Frage von sehr viel schwerwiegenderer Bedeutung. Und deswegen mache ich mir, und ich bin ja sicherlich nicht der Einzige, schon große Sorgen, ob eine Führungspersönlichkeit dieser Art in Washington sitzend als der, nicht wahr, seit vielen Jahrzehnten von ganzen Generationen von Westeuropäern und übrigens auch aus anderen Teilen der Welt als sozusagen the beacon of hope and the future angesehene Insasse des Weißen Hauses, wenn der sich plötzlich so äußern würde, wie es Donald Trump jetzt im Vorwahlkampf tut. Ich hätte große Sorgen, wie dadurch, um es salopp auszudrücken, der Atlantik tatsächlich möglicherweise sehr rasch, sehr viel breiter werden könnte, die Frage einer klugen, gemeinsamen transatlantischen Politik riesige Probleme aufwerfen könnte. Also ich will das jetzt gar nicht im Einzelnen ausführen, ich wollte nur diesen Punkt machen. Zweiter Punkt, Russland. Wir wollen ja hier eine interessante Diskussion führen und ich möchte gerne den Punkt machen, dass ich glaube, dass fast alles, was wir in den letzten, sagen wir mal, 2 bis 3 Jahren an russischen Handlungen erlebt haben, sowohl nach innen, also zum Beispiel die Aufgabe der Modernisierung des Landes, die war in der ersten Ära Putin ein großes Thema, sie war auch noch ein Thema unter Medvedev und plötzlich ist das Thema der Modernisierung der Gesellschaft, der Wirtschaft aus dem Repertoire, aus der Prioritätenliste anscheinend sehr weit nach hinten gerückt. In der Außenpolitik, ich will das jetzt gar nicht wiederholen, ich stimme damit überein, dieses Auftrumpfen, dieses mit nacktem Oberkörper sozusagen rumlaufen, das ist ja auch ein gewisses Zeichen einer Verrohung in der Art, wie sich russische Politik präsentiert. Ich habe gestern, viele von Ihnen werden es auch gesehen haben, diesen stellvertretenden russischen Parlamentspräsidenten beobachtet, wie der tatsächlich sagt, weiter so Jungs, was diese Unflätigkeiten der Hooligans in Frankreich angeht. Das ist Zeichen einer Verrohung der Sitten und ist vielleicht auch leider bezeichnend für das Beispiel, mit dem da seitens des Kreml vorangegangen wird. Ich glaube, dass all das, und das ist der Punkt, den ich machen wollte, nicht Zeichen russischer Stärke sind, sondern Zeichen russischer Schwäche. Vergessen wir nicht, und ich will damit nichts entschuldigen, das heißt ja nicht, dass wir das dann durchwinken, aber man muss schon sehen, mit wem wir es hier zu tun haben, dass das nominale Bruttosozialprodukt der Europäischen Union zusammengenommen liegt in der Größenordnung von 16 Billionen. Das Bruttosozialprodukt in nominalen Terms der Russischen Föderation ist geringer als das von Italien und etwas größer als das von Spanien. Das heißt, die Europäische Union verfügt über, wenn man es genau ausrechnet, 12 bis 14 Mal so viel, zumindest wirtschaftliche Macht. Und das bringt mich zu meinem dritten und letzten Punkt. Ich habe, das sind eigentlich 2 kleine Punkte, ich habe in Jahren keine Rede über Europa und an die Europäer erlebt, die so inspirierend war wie die kürzliche Rede von Präsident Obama in Hannover. Und manchmal denke ich, es wäre ganz schön, wenn Europa Führungspersönlichkeiten hätte, die in dieser Weise uplifting und stolzerzeugend den der halben Milliarde Europäer zu rufen, wir sind doch wer. Nicht nur, wir schaffen das, das ist ja auch wichtig, aber wir sind wer. Wir haben eine Menge geschaffen in diesem halben Jahrhundert der Europäischen Union. Das fehlt mir gelegentlich. Und der Schlusspunkt dessen, was ich hier eingangs sagen wollte, ist genau zu diesem Punkt. Ich glaube, der Europäischen Union fehlt es in der Außen- und Sicherheitspolitik natürlich auch an der Hardware. Wir haben keine Armee und so weiter und so weiter. Aber es fehlt uns vor allem am Gestaltungswillen. Im vergangenen Sommer war es doch jedem, der lesen und sehen konnte, klar, dass die Flüchtlingswelle nicht etwa auf Pennsylvania Avenue oder auf dem Roten Platz im Kreml ankommen würde, sondern exakt hier in der Mitte Europas. Das war nun jedem klar. Und als einige wenige versucht haben zu sagen, wie wäre es denn, wenn die Europäische Union, wir haben immerhin einen Präsidenten, der heißt Tusk, und wir haben eine Frau Mogherini, wie wäre es denn, wenn die Europäische Union sich jetzt mal aufraffen würde und zu einer großen internationalen Konferenz einladen würde mit drei Zielen. Erstens, Behandlung des Flüchtlingsdramas. Zweitens, Beendigung des Kriegs in Syrien. Und drittens, die Frage der regionalen Rehabilitation, des Wiederaufbaus für Syrien und die Umgebung. Wer sowas damals im vergangenen Sommer vorgeschlagen hat, wurde abgetan als Illusionist. 6 Wochen später haben John Kerry und Sergei Lavrov, ich muss sagen, dankenswerterweise, genau diese Initiative ergriffen, haben die ganze Truppe nach Wien eingeladen. Wieso können wir nicht für 500 Millionen Menschen sprechend die Initiative ergreifen und selber einladen? Uns, der Europäischen Union, fehlt hier, denke ich, ein ordentliches Quäntchen Selbstbewusstsein. Und man möge mir bitte nicht erzählen, das liegt nur daran, dass wir militärisch nicht stark genug sind. Ich glaube, die wären alle gekommen, wenn wir, natürlich unterstützt von den Staats- und Regierungschefs, wenn die Europäische Union eine solche Initiative ergriffen hätte. Also mehr Selbstbewusstsein, dann sind wir auch ein besserer und anerkannterer Partner für die USA.
Vielen Dank. Vielen Dank, Herr Ischinger. Ich würde auch gerne mit Ihnen noch über Deutschland reden. Das hat Angela Stern auch getan und Ralf Füchs eingangs. Aber wir haben ja Zeit. Da können wir noch ein wenig weiter sammeln. Insofern freue ich mich, dass wir Raja Mohan mit an Bord holen können in unser Gespräch. Wenn Sie sich aus Ihrer Perspektive.
Ja. Thank you. Thank you. So I want to begin by thanking the Bowl Foundation for inviting me. I was a bit surprised too, not because I was called an outsider, but what would a realist do in a garden full of idealists of the kind of the green activists that are gathered here? So if I say something is going to
very friendly faces for
yeah,
now.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But when I heard Ralph speak this evening, some of my doubts were reduced, and I think there is room here, and I think. For a genuine dialogue between realists and idealists. Because I think when circumstances change, what seems impossible becomes necessary and possible. It is really the circumstances. And I think we have put ourselves in a circumstance today where many of the assumptions that we made in the last 25 to 30 years are going to be overthrown, if not intellectually, by politics of it. What we see with Trump, or what we see in France, or what we see in Russia, that the circumstances, the politics of it is going to undo many of the illusions that we have constructed for ourselves. And I think that is going to be, and I think for that, we need an open dialogue between competing ideas and views. And I think I'm delighted to be here. So let me also make 3 points. I mean, I think the first one about Russia, as you know, we Indians, I mean, we've been once allies of the Soviet Union. We were, whatever India says about non-alignment, you don't have to take it seriously, that when US, China, and Pakistan were on one side, India drew closer to the Soviet Union. So that's again was part of a circumstance. But what surprises me today is it's not that Russia has been so successful, that actually Europe has become so weak. That today what to see the triumph of Russian assertiveness speaks more about Europe's failures than Russia's great success. I mean, as you were just mentioning, the material capabilities of Russia are so limited compared to what Europe can bring to bear. And yet what we've seen, a Europe that seems increasingly rudderless, jerked around by the Russians, in being invaded by, I don't want to use, we are in a public position, these so-called barbarians from the south, and the English are leaving you, and then you have the Americans are very distracted. Now, this requires, I think, a very different approach to Russia. I think this assumption that it was all a fault of Russia, that what happened, but what is quite clear is the 89 to 91 political understandings that were arrived in Europe have broken down. I don't think there's any doubt about that. But is Russia the only one responsible for it? Has Europe handled the moment for the first 10 years after 89 when Russia was crawling? Did we do that right? I think those questions, I mean, I'm not going to tell you what the answers are, but I think those questions will have to be asked. But in any case, that is merely an academic inquiry. But the fact is that today, it is not a choice between Russia, the evil, and something else. I mean, I think the choices are always between good and not so good, bad and not so bad, bad and very bad. If that is the situation that you're faced with, I think the Europe has no option. That's where I disagree slightly with Angela, that at some point, some accommodation, temporary, limited to a particular circumstance, a particular area, a particular domain, a particular sector, without a limited accommodation with Russia, Europe's problems will get a lot worse. And I think the idea that somehow you can continue to fight with Russia, re-modernize NATO, and yet be relevant to the world, I mean, I think that's quite shocking. And I think Angela said something about, while you're clear about Russia trying to undo a revisionist Russia, we don't know really about what China is doing. But sitting in Asia, we see what China is doing is far more consequential. And we are shocked that China gets a pass on so many things, while Russia is criticized for every little thing. China is still ruled by an official Communist Party. I mean, they're overturning international law, building non-Western institutions. That is the reality we face in Asia. And I don't see how in Asia we can construct any type of balance without some role for Russia in it. So it's not a question of Russia being nice or Putin being nice, but it is a question of which is the bigger challenge today. I mean, I think strategy in the end is about making those choices. And I think Europe will have to make those choices in the near future, because the consequences of not making those choices and a Europe that remains riveted to a narrow conception of its own region is going to be even less relevant. Because I think it's quite because I think what we see from Asia, look, we need a strong Europe. A Europe that is divided will actually make it that much harder for us. A Europe divided will be ripe for picking by the Chinese. I mean, already what the Chinese do in Europe, in different parts of Europe, in terms of their access to high technology, the way they were reaching out to Europe, that a Europe that is divided is unwilling to deal with its, translate its physical material resources into strategic capabilities would be serious loss for many of us. I mean, I was deeply skeptical of Europe as an empire of norms. Look, I mean, that holiday is over. That luxury of claiming yourself as an empire of norms. The question is, does Europe have the strategic competence today to deal with the larger issues that have emerged? And I think that is the question. Therefore, we really hope that Europe will emerge as a strategic actor, an actor that will deal with the larger issues and not just within its own neighborhood. Because what you're going to do in the Middle East is going to be affected by what China does there, what India does there, what Russia does there. What you're going to do in any other part of this world is connected to what we call Eurasia today. Russians use the term, Indians use the term, a lot of people are using the term. Because if you keep fighting with Russia, the Japanese have a problem with how to deal with Russia, because we, India, Japan, want Russia to be part of a nation alliance. We can't do that if this is what's going on here. So therefore, I would say that making those choices means that Europe will have to work with other middle powers in Eurasia. Not because you're running away from the Americans or Americans are running away from you. If the Americans are going to downsize even 10% of the role, That would require a different approach from the Europeans, and that would necessarily involve working with other democracies, a point that Ralph mentioned in his presentation, that you've got to find ways of working with India, with Japan, with Australia, to do that alternative framing. It's not just about being in the lines. I'm going to finish up. So I think that is the big challenge, and my sense is, but if Europe fails, my sense is Germany is going to get even a bigger responsibility. That Germany is going to, as a country that can actually act as a bridge between Russia and the West, that responsibility of constructing a different framework is going to be even bigger on you. So let me stop by saying good luck.
Very good. Thank you very much, Raja. I was just wondering whether, Angela, you don't want to respond briefly to, because you would directly addressed by Raja in some of the things you said, because we have a few more minutes and I'd like to seize that opportunity, wenn Sie möchten. Eine ganz kurze Reaktion an der Stelle noch und dann machen wir weiter in unserer Dramaturgie, bitte.
Well, I think Wolfgang should address the question of Europe and its engagement mm-hmm. with China and, mm-hmm. and the rest of India. You know, I understand, you know, your threat perception depends on where you are. So obviously you are at least in one, at least one organization with China and Russia, the BRICS, and that you know, India has obviously has had a traditional relationship both with the Soviet Union and with Russia, and that, you know, India, for instance, abstained, as did the other BRIC countries, and the vote in the United Nations General Assembly on Crimea and things like that. It is a different threat perception, but I think you know, if you live in Europe or even in the United States, the United States obviously is very worried about what China is doing in the South China Sea. It sees that as a, you know, in the long run as a major challenge to, you know, the order there. But I think it equally sees what's happened, you know, in Ukraine and the fact that Russia is essentially trying to foment and support instability in most of its neighbors. I mean, that's its modus operandi. Ukraine, we've seen Georgia, Moldova. You know, it could be in other places, you know, represents equally a challenge. So I think Wolfgang should maybe take the part of that.
Do you want to just briefly respond directly, Raja, because you started to sort of move around on your seat? Okay, then we have Wolfgang Ischinger, and it was not a 30-second intervention, Wolfgang Ischinger.
I just wanted to remind, in the UN, the Germans and us two voted together on Libya. And I think we proved to be right in retrospect. But on Crimea, I don't think it's about, look, we have Kashmir, so there's no way we're going to support what the Russians have done in Crimea, nor the Chinese in Tibet. So you just keep quiet sometimes when your friends do bad things, but that's not a good idea. But there is no question of India supporting the Russian occupation and then legitimizing it through those means. Sorry, yeah, I was just saying that Crimea, India never supports Crimea because we have a problem in Kashmir. We're not going to legitimize what the Russians have done because that's exactly what the Pakistanis and others want, you know, hold a referendum by using military force. So I don't think that's a problem. I've also said that what Obama was saying about in that magazine in Atlantic Monthly, he's saying you can't win a contest with Russia in Ukraine. Now, I think that leads to, inevitably, that ceding is limited sphere of influence for Russia. It's unpalatable as it is at some point. I think that will that reality will sink in.
Und der Ball, das haben wir auch gehört von Angela Stent, wurde ganz deutlich in Richtung Europa gerollt und darunter auch Deutschland. Jetzt sind wir doch bei Deutschland angekommen. Eine kurze Einschätzung Ihrerseits, Herr Ischinger.
Ja, es sind ja jetzt ganz viele Punkte angesprochen worden. Ich würde gerne doch kurz zu dem Thema Asien, China eine Anmerkung machen. Ja, es ist bedauerlich. Also ich war vor einer Woche oder vor 10 Tagen bei dem sogenannten Shangri-La Dialog in Singapur. Und es hat mich nicht überrascht, aber es hat mich schon geärgert, dass auch heute im Jahre 2016 Europa, die EU oder einzelne Mitglieder der Europäischen Union, einschließlich der Bundesrepublik Deutschland, vollkommen abwesend sind vom Radarschirm der strategischen Überlegung dort. Also das ist bedauerlich. Die Bundeskanzlerin ist ja in den letzten Tagen in China gewesen. Und ich glaube, wir werden über kurz oder lang gezwungen sein, wir als EU, nicht nur den Versuch zu machen, noch mehr BMWs in China zu verkaufen, was lobenswert ist, sondern wir werden gezwungen sein, auch Farbe zu bekennen. Eine Position zu haben zu dem Inselstreit beispielsweise, South China Seas, zu anderen kritischen Fragen der Region. Wir müssen erkennen, dass das, was in Ostasien passiert, und ich widerspreche Rajamohan ja überhaupt nicht, manche Aktivitäten Chinas beunruhigen mich genauso, wie mich manche Aktivitäten Moskaus beunruhigen. Und damit müssen wir uns auseinandersetzen. Es wird notwendig sein, dass die Europäische Union eine China- und Ostasien-Politik entwickelt. Die haben wir nicht, noch nicht mal im Ansatz. Wir wissen heute noch nicht mal, ob die Europäische Union der Meinung ist, dass China eine Market Economy sein sollte oder nicht. Also damit fängt es ja schon mal an. Die Streitereien gehen dann in große strategische Fragen. Wir betreiben China-Politik nach wie vor als deutsche China-Politik, französische China-Politik. Jeder versucht dort so viel wie möglich zu verkaufen, mit dem Ergebnis, dass wir strategisch nicht vorkommen. Das ist leider der Punkt. Ich würde aber einschränkend sagen, es gibt vieles, was in der Außenpolitik wünschenswert wäre. Nicht alles, was wünschenswert ist, ist auch machbar. Und man muss auch Prioritäten setzen. Ich glaube, für die Europäische Union ist heute tatsächlich die Auseinandersetzung mit Russland in und um die Ukraine, ist auch die Auseinandersetzung mit einer Vielzahl von Instabilitätsrisiken, beispielsweise in Südosteuropa, in Mazedonien kracht es im Augenblick, an anderen Orten könnte es demnächst auch wieder krachen. Wenn wir diese Fragen vor unserer eigenen Haustür nicht als Gesellenstück erfolgreich erledigen können, dann brauchen wir uns mit den großen Jungs, mit den Indern und mit den Chinesen, nicht auf dieselbe Ebene zu begeben. Also ich glaube, hier sind viele Hausaufgaben zu erledigen. Lassen wir noch einen Punkt machen, wenn
vielleicht
ich darf.
Ganz ja. Klein, denn wir haben ja gleich in der Runde noch Gelegenheit, das Ganze etwas systematischer nochmal aufzufächern. Insofern, wenn es an dieser Stelle in aller Kürze ist, das wäre prima.
Ja, ich wollte, Sie wollten ja von mir einen Satz zu Deutschland haben. Ich finde, die Bundesregierung und auch die Opposition, die hier versammelte Opposition, haben erstaunlicherweise etwas in Gang gesetzt, was ich vor 2-3 Jahren mir kaum vorstellen konnte, weil ich davon ausgegangen bin, dass es in Deutschland eine unglaublich starke Neigung zum Status Quo-Denken gibt und dass es für die Politik enorm schwierig war und auch noch ist, den Deutschen beizubringen, dass da draußen das Rad des Wandels sich immer schneller dreht und dass es nicht möglich sein wird, Wohlstandssicherheit etc. pp. Hier in Deutschland zu bewahren, wenn wir uns auch nicht einem ständigen Wandel unterziehen. Und der schließt natürlich die Außen- und Sicherheitspolitik und die Verteidigungspolitik mit ein. Ich finde es sehr erfreulich, dass sich da Prozesse ergeben haben, nicht zuletzt durch die Gauck'sche Rede und so weiter in München und die Folgen und die Debatte, die sich daraus ergeben hat. Und eine Debatte, die aus meiner Sicht in die richtige Richtung führt, wenn, und das wäre mein letzter Punkt, weil mich der zurückführt zum Thema Europa, wenn es die Bundesrepublik Deutschland schafft, ihre sogenannte gesteigerte Verantwortung und ihre Bereitschaft, diese Verantwortung auch auszuüben, in den Dienst einer hoffentlich handlungsfähigeren und einigeren Europäischen Union zu stellen. Es kann nicht darum gehen, dass dass sozusagen die Europäische Union immer stärker durch Deutschland geführt wird. Das wäre ein Holzweg, der würde nicht gut enden. Sondern es geht darum, dass Deutschland seine Kraft, seine Wirtschaftskraft, seine politischen Fähigkeiten in den Dienst einer Europäischen Union stellt, die das dringend braucht. Die braucht eine Vitaminspritze. Wir sind einer der wenigen, die diese Vitaminspritze der EU verabreichen können.
Ja, vielen Dank Ihnen dreien für diese Runde. Sie sehen, wir sind im Weiteren dabei zu sammeln, also zu schauen, was sind Perspektiven, was sind Themenkomplexe, die wir jetzt im Weiteren noch diskutieren wollen. Danke sehr herzlich, Angela Stent, dass Sie uns hineingeführt haben in diesen ersten Aufschlag, dass Raja Mohan uns den Spiegel vorgehalten hat und auch morgen uns natürlich weiter bereichern wird mit seiner Expertise. Ich möchte in diesem Augenblick jetzt Folgendes sagen zum weiteren Ablauf. Der Abend ist ja noch etwas länger, insofern gibt es jetzt die Möglichkeit einer kleinen Pause, damit alle ein wenig die Beine strecken können, frische Luft schnappen können. Und ich schaue mal in die Regie unten rein. Wir haben 20 Minuten in etwa Zeit, wenn Sie so freundlich wären, dass Sie so kurz vor sechs wieder hier sind. Denn dann werden wir hier das Podium bereichern um weitere Gäste und werden also noch mal tiefer einsteigen in viele der Dinge, die wir hier in aller Kürze erstmal sehr spannend, aber natürlich auch nur anreißen konnten. Bleiben Sie dabei, bis gleich und herzlichen Dank Ihnen dreien schon einmal.